Hi, everybody. Welcome to Berna Öney Research Media. My name is Mohamed Haddad. I am the editor-in-chief of Berna Öney, which is a Tunisia-based think tank and media. Today, you are watching right now the podcast about why are you a researcher, Alish Behef. The idea is simple. We interview researchers, asking them about their research. Why did they choose this research, and what surprised them most, and what is the impact of their research, if any? Today, we have the pleasure to have with us Berna Öney, who is a postdoc fellow at the Social Sciences Institute at University of Oldenburg, which is in Germany. And she has just published a paper with Murat Ardag, and the paper's name is What Constitutes the Political Culture Differences Between Egypt and Tunisia During and After the Uprisings. First of all, thank you so much, Berna Öney, for accepting our invitation.
Thanks for having me.
And let me start by the very first question, which is, how did you end up working on this topic with this data and in this period?
Okay, so you want to specifically concentrate on the research, your question?
We can start by okay. The research, and then if you want to broaden the scope of the conversation, please feel free.
Yeah, so it's a co-authored work, and my co-authored work with Dr. Arda, we were really curious about the dynamics of political change that started with the Arab uprisings. And many scholars published research on this issue, but we couldn't find any investigation specifically related to the political culture. Unfortunately, there's a tendency to treat political culture as a given, something inherent or fixed. And when it comes to political regime changes, much research focuses on institutions or systems to explain where this change comes from. And what remained under-researched was what has been going on at the individual level or societal level. So we wanted to know whether the divergence in the Tunisian and Egyptian political experience change, political regime change experience depends on the political cultural differences.
And you used quantitative methods.
Yes.
In field where the quantitative means are not very common, let's say. So tell us more. I mean, I read the paper, but it was like you need to have some concepts of math, of statistics, and of network analysis in order to get the full meaning. So tell us more about that. You used the waves of the Arab barometer that were happening from 2011 to 2018. What did you do with this data that was not done before?
Ah, good question. That's a question for my co-author mainly, because he's an expert on the specific network, Bayesian network analysis and everything. But I would say what differed our research from the previous ones is, firstly, we took a longer time of period. And theoretically, we know that certain notions are already connected to one another. But we didn't want to make this assumption. We wanted to take every notion, democratic notion, let's say, related to the political culture, or we say political culture notions, to be itself. And then without forcing them to get in relationship with one another. So, and by plotting these networks, we see how they're connected. And each wave of data obviously showed us a different picture, and which was in a way an evidence for us that political culture is something changing, it's alive. It is very much affected by the social environment, political environment, and people's, even these long, deep seated values are open to change. So
what would you define as a political culture orientation for people who didn't read the paper?
Sure. that's a really good question, because sometimes there's a tendency to mix it up with public opinion. So political culture orientations refer to people's deep-seated norms, preferences, and beliefs. Whereas public opinion, for instance, about short-term reactions of citizens toward government and public policy. So when we talk about these deep-seated norms, let's say the role of Islam, for instance, in politics, we take it as a deep-seated norm. The way you see the world, obviously politics about how you perceive the world, and the values that comes, the core values, for instance, the role of Islam would have an impact how you interpret the political or social world, right? And in our research, for instance, we show that it is interactive with the change, political change. So even these core deep-seated values are open to, let's say, they evolve, or if we call it evolve. So these are kind of the let's say, political culture orientations as we refer.
I would like to ask you a more personal question. How did you personally end up working on this kind of topics? I mean, as a political scientist, I guess this is this discipline you would relate to. How did you end up working on this? I mean,
I decided to study democratization. Let's narrow it down a little bit, political science, but what I'm doing is comparative politics and mainly about democratization studies. And I decided to study democratization in the Middle East and North African region in my bachelor years, because the research findings were not entirely convincing to me. First, there was a literature out there, maybe today outdated, but strongly argued that Islam constituted a hindrance to democracy and democratization. And later, I guess it was 2002, finally, an important academic figure accepted in field, he argued that it's not Islam per se. That was very, you know, a big argument, a big step. But this time the argument turned into something else by saying that Arab culture impedes democracy. And these findings were misleading and inaccurate from my perspective. So mainly much research has been done from a Western academic perspective. Today, I must say that we haven't really totally revolutionized the way we do scientific research and got rid of our prejudices. Still, at least we can publish objective research findings that confirm that political culture in the Muslim world, or particularly the Arab world, does not hinder democracy, or it might even harbor a democratic mindset. So that was my main motivation, honestly.
And here I cannot not ask you this question, which is, you as, I guess, a Turkish, are you, I don't know, maybe I'm yes. Assuming, yes. Because you were speaking about the Western researchers with their biases, etc. So the fact that you are not a Western researcher, that you come from a country which is from the region, but which is not an Arab country, but that where Islam is the most important religion, how, and being, I mean, a woman, I guess now you're in a German institution, how did this all mix up? How would you describe your biases? What was the hardest part in challenging your biases, or who you are while working on this study?
Wow, that's a very challenging question. I mean, all my education was based on Western academic perspective. I mean, I attended one of the most distinguished universities in Turkey. The language was English, obviously, the teaching language. And then in my master's, again, such an environment. But on the other hand, I was living in the society, right? That I was aware that, I would say, my social environment was very conducive to questioning the establishment while meeting, you know, I met so many different individuals from various backgrounds. I mean, countries like Tunisia, Egypt, Turkey, you see big, you know, a large, let's say, large spectrum, broad spectrum of ideological differences. So that contributed to my understanding because obviously you have your own political standing, right? And you meet individuals from different perspectives. It's really important to listen and understand. And that's also, I think, one of the success of Tunisia in that sense, opening a dialogue and listen to one another. That's really crucial. So that's why I could hear the opposite sides, you know, in the different factions of the society. And that also kind of encouraged me to do research on democratization, because even those ideas that I oppose, I could feel that those people are had a democratic mindset, you know? And plus as a woman, poof, that's also another dimension, I suppose. I must say we all have our prejudices personally, but that's why I like about, you know, being a researcher where you put everything behind and you just work with your data. And whatever data tells you, that's the objectivity that you can reach at least some level. I'm not sure if I answered your question.
You did. And thank you so much. That's really interesting to acknowledge and to have the story of your career path and your life, basically, and how you end up having a very original angle on the topic and the other object of your research. What did surprise you the most in this specific paper, or more broadly in your career as a researcher, maybe in your PhD or in other papers? What is the thing that was just blew your mind?
I think in general, political science, at least that's my feeling, we're living at an age that it's very difficult to find something very, very surprising and get it published, to be honest. But just for this paper, I can say there are two exciting results for me. The most exciting one probably was about the motivational difference between Egyptians and Tunisians in overthrowing the dictators and establishing the different political regime. Our findings show that Egyptians were mainly motivated by economic situation, economic dissatisfaction, while Tunisians were driven by their desire for democratic freedom. So the economy has been an important factor for both countries, obviously, but for Tunisians, it was not enough to consider political regime change. It was more about freedoms. And the second interesting result for me was the change, political change, or the social change, I would say, from 2011 to 2013, that the Tunisians began questioning the suitability of democracy for their country, I suppose, due to challenging these 2 years in between. And is democracy the right regime for us? Is such a core question, which I think all non-Western countries at some point should explicitly ask themselves. So in other words, the question is, how can we establish a system that corresponds to our social and political values that meet the democratic criteria? And every society should deliberate on this question. And the honesty of questioning the existing notions of democracy and its suitability of Tunisia both surprised me and actually gave me hope for the region's future.
Wow, thank you so much. That's really insightful. And so thinking about democratic values in a system that would stem from the place where people are, not like importing foreign direct investment, which is democratic values with like, you're democratic and not democratic. And that's one of the things that surprised me and that pleased me most, which is the concept you're using of democratization, which is not a black or white thing where you whether you're democratic or not. And so democratization is, let's say, has in itself the de-democratization process, which is a phase that goes from on the other way, and which is not like a monopoly of Arab countries or emerging countries.
Definitely, yeah.
What about the impact of research? I know that every time I ask a researcher about this, he says, come on, research should not be about being useful or efficient or having a clear impact. But what do you think about that? What do you think about the impact that these results that you've just told us about could have, what's the impact they could have today on the fields you're studying, which are like Tunisia and a Tunisian society and Egyptian society, or more broadly?
I don't reject the idea of useful research. Then if it's not useful, why do we do research? I mean, it's not just a self-pleasure thing, right? I do the research, learn the, get the result. And what's important is to share and disseminate the knowledge, because all we want to, I think all researchers, all people in the world want to have a, want to live in a better world, right? So to me, there's the notion of usefulness. Frankly, I don't think that accumulating research on the Middle East and North Africa will have an imminent impact on the broader comparative politics literature, at least not anytime soon. Comparative political research is still dominated by the literature on Western countries and the European Union. And there are historical reasons for this. And I surely don't want to sound too cynical. Though it's promising to observe that comparative work is accumulating, especially with the availability of public opinion data from the MENA region, and the accumulated evidence will eventually lead to more informed, most similar, most different country comparison designs. And by the way, I mean country comparisons within the region, as well as comparative research across the different regions of the world. So I guess our research's most notable impact is broadening the perspective for formulating research questions on the Middle East and North African region, in that sense.
That's great, thank you. Is there anything you would like to highlight or to add on our conversation? I want to make it short so that people get the whole, I will add the link, of course, in the description, but is there anything you would like to add to specify?
The takeaway message that, you know, as a researcher working on democratization, I assume that the mainly Tunisians will watch this. Democratization is a rocky road. It's not easy. It's not short. There are no shortcuts. It is painful, the process. And we have to keep our hopes high and then work on it and really listen to each other, understand, create a dialogue, you know, an open environment, and just respect each other. That's the takeaway message I would like to share, give.
And the PS question is, your title is Two Stories with One Happy Ending and What Constitutes, etc., what I read in the beginning. Do you still, I know this is out of the scope of your research, but do you still consider that there is one, at least one happy ending, or zero or two, considering what happened?
There is no ending,
summer?
Right?
Ah, okay.
this is always a never ending story. So none of the countries existing in the world say, oh, we reach the democratic level, it's done. It is the changes. I mean, we see that time changes, right? The needs change, people's mindset, new. I mean, even in 2020 we're dealing with extremists, for instance. So this is not normal from my perspective, all the debates that we're having, and on the other hand we have these extremist mindsets. So it's a never-ending story. The challenges are never ending, but at least the time period we considered for our research, we decided to come up with this title because for us, Tunisian experience is really giving a lesson and also gives hope, I would say.
Thank you so much again for your time, Berna Öney. Thank you for sharing your thoughts, your research, your outcomes, and for the work you're doing. It was a pleasure, and I hope to have the opportunity to talk to you soon about your coming research. Let me wish you a very happy new year, 2022, and hope to see you soon. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for having me. It was my pleasure, and happy new year.
Happy new year. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.